nina sendol ka ke mo fa seda.
Hello everybody and welcome to Talking in Stations. I am your interim host for today because Matterall is out in the woods somewhere for I don't know what reason. I'm Nystrik, hello, and I'm joined as always by Ashterothi and our guest today, Jin'taan. Jin, do you want to go ahead and tell us a bit about who you are and what you do in Eve?
Hello, yeah, I am the head FC for Provi Block, a sitting member of CSM 11, and the co-host of the Declarations of War podcast with Alexia Card.
Alright, and what about you, Ashterothi? I know you're here every week, but tell us a bit about yourself.
Yeah, I am Ashterothi. I am a writer for Crossing Zebras. I am on this podcast, plus a couple of my own, including Hydrag and Hydrostatic. And I am the acting commander of Aideron Robotics.
All right, so before we get into what we're going to talk about, I know, Ashterothi, you've been super busy lately doing stuff in Eve. So what have you been up to in Eve?
Yeah, it's kind of interesting. We're going to talk more about this later, but I wrote an article at the beginning of this week that was kind of more negative, which had an interesting response because I usually have a much more negative, or sorry, positive canter, optimistic canter. So a lot of people kind of called me out on my negativity, which was true. So there's a bunch of soul searching. So I've actually been running a bunch of missions today, just kind of going back to the basics, my equivalent of going out to the woods and, you know, pulling a throw and learning simplicity. But on top of that, also Aideron Robotics is kind of entering into our next phase of development. We have a lot of bloat where a lot of people have been in the game, you know, over the last 5-6 years, we've collected a lot of people who have unfortunately left us. So I've been doing the Great Purge, where we carefully assembled kind of a list of criteria to still remain in the corp, and now I'm doing the harrowing duty of kind of going through and removing everybody who doesn't qualify. So you know, just more stuff that it takes to run one of these kinds of organizations. I've been really kind of engaged, and also on top of that, we've been doing some pretty crazy even battleship fleets. We had 2 battleship fleets in the last couple of weeks, which for faction warfare is pretty unusual, but we were working with the larger Galente militia, which was pretty cool. One of them went really, really well. The other one went really poorly. So pretty much.
So they evened out.
Yeah. I survived both of them. So for me, it's all good.
What about you, Jin? What have you kind of been up to in Eve lately? Or have you been more focused on out-of-game stuff?
Well, I never try and focus on out-of-game stuff. I definitely think that I have a responsibility to actually play this goddamn game, because it is fucking wonderful. Personally, the biggest thing that happened to CVA recently is we got dropped from Faction Warfare because we are awful and can't manage our standings. but other than that, we have entered the Alliance Tournament, which is something I'm very, very happy about.
Yay.
I might not be captain, but I love competitive gaming at pretty much all levels, so it's absolutely wonderful to be involved in that in my favorite game, which is Eve Online.
You and I have that in common, because if there's anything that brings me back to I really want to play Eve, it's always, always, always the Alliance Tournament, because I love it every year, and I watch every competitive esport you can think of. I will consume it like a crazy person, so when the Alliance Tournament happens, I am there. And for those of you in chat wondering where everyone else is, the answer is, I don't know. Matterall was like, here, do this thing. So I'm doing this thing, and everyone else is away for reasons I don't know. Sorry.
Okay, this is effectively, you're just moderating a head-v-head versus me and Ash wrote the afternoon.
I know, I'm really excited. So we're going to jump into this, because Ash, he alluded to this, and so you guys know the article is being displayed on your screen. It's called Eve is Dying and We're the Ones Killing It, and which is unusual for Ash because, yes, especially on our show, and I know I've only done it like 3 or 4 times, but Ash is very much our kind of hope for Eve voice. Eve is great, there's all these things you're missing out on, and the PvE is fantastic, even though most of us, mostly me, think, oh god, PvE, I wanna die. So, it's weird to see this kind of negativity come from Ash, and I'm excited to kind of see what he has to say about when you wrote it, so kind of your thoughts when you were writing it, and sort of your thoughts now after the fact.
Yeah, also, I have another piece that I've written that hasn't made it all the way through the pipe yet. I'm not sure if it's going to be published because it's way more kind of bloggy, so it may not actually end up on Crossing Zebras, but I'll put it somewhere else if it doesn't make it there. It really was an introspection about all of this. So I guess part of my problem, and I think as I was responding to the feedback, it caused me to think a lot more about what I was actually trying to say, which probably would have been good to have that once over before I posted it. But
that's
anyway,
what editors are for.
Yeah,
well, I'm just kidding.
It's true.
CZ doesn't really do style editing in that manner.
Most places
basically
don't.
It's pretty good. I don't mind that.
They wouldn't kick back my article and say, "Are you?" Well, actually, let me be fair. Nydan actually did pull me aside at this and asked me if I was sure about the title specifically. And I do admit, going into this, that the title was designed to be it was inflammatory. It was designed to be exciting. It was designed to tie into that notion of every summer we evaluate, is Eve dying?
I think you accomplished that. The only negative side of that is that a lot of people were like, Eve is dying, fuck you, and turned away.
Well, no, actually, I didn't actually get a lot of people that said that. But
oh, that's
like,
good.
What you saw was that knee-jerk response, because people are so exhausted with having that argument that they just saw that I was presenting that argument and then just basically copy-pasted their argument that they give whenever anybody says that Eve is dying.
Yep.
And then just acted like I was another person. I was accused of being goons, which was kind of funny.
That doesn't surprise me.
I think my favorite thing about that was that people effectively proved one of the points you brought up in the article, where you talked about how people will shout down someone if they think they're saying something that's been said before and say, why don't you read the backlog? And then people did exactly that right back to you, which I thought was quite amusing.
It also,
irony perspective.
It also proves another one of the points you made, and I think this is one of the latter points. I'm going to kind of summarize for you guys just really quick, so you know what's going on. The article makes a few accusations kind of at the community, less at CCP and more at the community of EVE, and one of the big ones is that hostilities in the game have kind of spilt over into the real world, and that by and large it's that them versus us mentality that's killing EVE, creative projects in EVE, even going so far as I think to, and I'm not sure that I read this right, and correct me if I'm wrong, but to accuse the them versus us mentality even you know, dripping into the CSM and kind of killing it as well. At least that's the accusation in the article.
Right. Well, and again, we're going to get more into this with Jin, because thankfully, of all of the pieces, all of my arguments that were made, this was the most resoundingly kind of disproven to my great pleasure, which is that I kind of, and again, this article was completely from just my perception at the time of me writing it, which has dramatically changed in the last week with people with this discussion. But,
right, but what you're saying is people were like, "Grr, you're goons," and kind of proving that them versus us mentality and how strong it is. And I mean, that's something we've talked about a lot on the show, especially, and how deeply it affects people in EVE.
That is correct. So they read specific parts of my argument and then made certain value judgments about who I was because of the arguments that I was making, and then lumped me with a group of people because of that, and then dismissed the article out of hand.
Yep.
By that, which is, I don't know if that's a straw man argument, but either way, you know, it's very interesting to watch it happen. And actually, there's a lot of meta to that too, because the whole notion of the argument that I wanted to make was that, you know, goons in particular, whether or not goons actually are the evil, like, villain that we make them out to be, there is this image of the way it was, and the fact that villainy and being just god-awful to each other was acceptable. And in a lot of ways, goons, for whatever reason, they've earned it or whatnot, they were in the centerpiece of kind of that power base of the just the truly bad to each other kind of people. And so the question then becomes, if you're going to justify a war against an ideology, because that's a lot of what the the war was about. Like, a lot of the people were there for money, but even more people were there because they wanted to once and for all stomp out this negative, the villains of
Gurgoons.
Goons. So, yeah, so the question then becomes...
Do you not think that that's a good thing? Do you not think that having a narrative behind the conflict, even if that conflict is driven by monetary gain, do you not think that there's something to be gained from having enemies and having an adversary in the game? Because I
think
personally
it's great.
Think that that's a core part of EVE.
I completely agree with you.
I think it's great. My question was, and I found it afterwards, and I was really mad that I didn't start the entire line or the entire piece with the Nietzsche quote where, you know, be careful when fighting monsters lest you become a monster, and if you stare into the abyss, you will find it staring back. I paraphrase. but that's basically what the entire message, what my frustrations was that in order to, what I watched happening within the community was that it was being rapidly divided into two different groups of people. There was the goon swarm and those who stood with them, who stood behind their iron wall of us versus them, and that look at them, everybody is coming to destroy us and we have only tried to build good things. And then there is the outside of it, which basically villainized that other group of people and spoke of unspeakable, terrible things over the course of a decade, and used those events in order to enact increasingly terrible things upon that group of people. And while that's cool to a certain extent, there is a point in which I think that we need to say that the war is over, and we need to figure out whether or not we are becoming the very terrible thing that we rallied against in order to destroy.
I think my biggest thing with your article, Ash, is where, you know, I read it and I thought, okay, well, you know, I can see where you're making some of your points, but I think the strongest point that I took away from it was the issue with the out-of-game tactics. And people probably say, oh, that's just because you're a goon, and I'm not really. I was in goons for a month, and then I quit EVE and haven't gone back. After being in test during the Fountain War, where I was very staunchly anti-goon, so that them versus us has been there for me for a really long time, because I came into test at a time where test was really trying to push back against goons. So, you know, it's fun to play a game when it's about in-game shooting ships versus shooting other ships, and whose ships are the best, and whose fleets are the best, and whose FCs are FCing their pilots the best to win the fight. It's a little difficult for me to swallow the pill of the goons have been eradicated and cultural victory, because it was all about out-of-game sort of money raining from the sky. How do you fight that?
Right. And I
all
think
right. So I'm gonna take advantage of being
no. Go ahead. Go ahead.
And say that I'm not a member of either side. I was very briefly a member of the Money Badger Coalition, but then got kicked out because I'm Provi and we can't control our spaghetti. But I don't think it was ever a war to eradicate goons. It was a war to eradicate the Imperium and what it stood for, because the Imperium, you have to understand, it was effectively a remnant of the Dominion Age, and mm-hmm. whilst there are some things I don't currently like about the Age's Sov system, and what people are calling the Fuzzy Sov Age now, it's, you know, it was very, very unbalancing to have one major coalition that was also allied with the only other major coalition, that's the DRF and the Imperium CFC, whatever you want to call it. And I actually talked about this in my own articles, I also write quite a lot, and it's something that I feel is less of an ideological war and more of a practical one, because having one empire that survived through what was effectively the strengths of friendships and existing bonds between their pilots was incredibly unbalancing to the game, in the same way that the NCPL alliance is.
Yeah, I will say it was fun to see goons kind of get a taste of their own medicine, where it's like, you've blobbed people to death, now be blobbed to death.
It was very poetic on certain levels, but I guess my thing is that I joined during the Tyrannus expansion, which meant I had a front row seat for Incarna and Incursions and all of those things, where I saw the potential for CCP to mess up, the potential for CCP to do well, and the potential for the EVE community to tear things apart. And the one thing that I don't think people talk about enough is that, you know, CCP lost 20% of their staff during Incarna. Like, if Crucible didn't happen, we probably wouldn't be playing EVE right now. And we were that close to the threshold. And so, and I even admit this in kind of my new piece or whatever, that there is a certain concern where I understand that EVE is in fact a fragile thing. We live in an age in which MMOs get shuttered all the time.
Yep.
I was playing Nosgoth, and that game was pretty fun. There's nothing wrong with it whatsoever, but they just never got it to catch on, and it got closed down before I even made it out of beta. And you know, that's really scary, because that's a game that I would like to be playing that I can't anymore because other people messed it up, or because it didn't actually catch on, and they didn't handle it correctly, or whatever it ends up being. So you know, there is a fear that, like, okay, it's fun to get to laugh at the Kickstarter or to be mad at goons for what they did with it or whatever you want to talk about, but let's be very clear, you know, the next Kickstarter is going to be that much harder to do. And we would live in a better world if Kickstarter books for EVE stories were a thing that could be done fairly easily. Andrew Groening created his book, and that created a really cool precedent. And it'd be nice if we could go back to that kind of mentality. When I, you know, in October, I said that 2016 was going to be the year of fan-made content. And and on the one hand, I do see some of that. But I think that the war has made, has definitely flavored that content, has turned it from storytelling to propaganda, which might be fine ultimately. But the question is, are we stifling each other, or are we destroying what we have in order to forward our in-game objectives? And if we are, then what damage does that do?
I reject your assumption that the Kickstarter was rejected by the community because it was a goon project. I'm just going to say that out now, so...
Okay, but why?
Know that I have that opinion. I personally believe that the Kickstarter was not effectively presented well to the community. It was presented to the community using underhanded manner through the attempted Reddit upgrading. It was... It was always sold to us as, you must make this happen for the community, and that's a very disingenuous tactic to use when you're doing a Kickstarter. The point of the Kickstarter is that you want people to feel like the Kickstarter is going towards a goal unto itself. The Kickstarter's goal should not have been, we want kickstarting books to be seen as a normal thing for you. The Kickstarter should have been a thing to... We want to make this cool book about this one war that we think is particularly interesting. Here's why we've chosen this war. Here's why we've chosen this writer. They needed to lay it out in a very logical, very detached from the game manner. And unfortunately, the TMC staff failed to do that, in my opinion. And that's why there was such public backlash about it. There obviously was some element of gurgoons in that. But that's always going to happen. You have to understand that some people can't see beyond the game. And whilst that's not a significant portion of the population, it does exist. Like, go ahead.
Allow me to clarify my point, because you are 100% correct. The mismanagement, and that was one of the other things about the piece, is very hard, because I wanted to be very neutral about it, because it's very easy to, once you start laying blame or start trying to pick apart the last few months, it's very easy to start casting blame upon the other people, which is, in its essence, the problem, right? Like all, never looking at your own behavior is kind of one of the problems that I'm trying to talk to. But you're absolutely correct. The major failing of the Kickstarter was a mismanagement of the Kickstarter. But my point is that was the energy, that was the thrust. But the tip of the spear, the thing that pierced, the thing that did the most damage, was the fact that much emphasis, that much power, that much thrust was channeled by the Gurgoon's hate that had been built up over the course of a decade. And so when there was that sense of weakness, they used that energy and they used that momentum in order to create further divisions. And then, of course, the Imperium didn't help anything by battering up their walls.
No. The article is, well, to a point, you know, reading them, I agreed. You know, it's like the points of the articles were to try to articulate that it doesn't matter really what we do. People will dislike what we do because we are who we are. And in some way, understanding kind of the history of the Imperium and especially of the TMC site, that's really how we felt. Like, it didn't matter what we did. People didn't like it because we were goons or because we were the Imperium, even if we felt like we were doing something good. And I'll completely agree with both of you that the Kickstarter and the way that it was done was shit. Yeah. But, and you know, it's unfortunate that that's kind of how things happened. But I will say that a lot of the kickback that was at least the most vocal was the goons are trying to make a book to make goons look good. And that was a lot of the vocal, of course, always the vocal minority, and that's what a lot of people heard. They heard
Tip, don't think that the main reason behind something is what gets upvoted on Reddit.
That's a terrible
idea in
life, I'm clear.
In everything in general.
I was going to say...
At Reddit for your opinions?
No.
Ron Paul would have won 2008, and currently Bernie Sanders would be winning right? the national elections in America.
No, I'm definitely not saying that that's why I think that that was the way that it was. Obviously, like I said, that was the part that was definitely heard the most.
Right. So, but I guess one of the big things is that a lot of that piece has been proven wrong, right? Like, it's the bottom line is that it's very easy for us to get into naysaying, especially given the fact that we are in the summer and there hasn't been a lot of information. But there's a lot of kind of stirrings in the background. I know CCP Fozzy just, I think, or not Fozzy, but Falcon just in the last day or two has said that there's a lot of more information coming out very soon. You know, it looks like they took off most of this month. That patch is coming out very soon. There's almost nothing in it. Well, okay, my bad. There's one big thing in it, and that's basically it, which shows me that, you know, they're just wrapping up on stuff, and they've got other projects that are crossing over into the next time cycle, which isn't necessarily a bad thing. And so there's still plenty of good opportunity for things to be going in a really good way. And so assuming that, like, we are in a bad path is... it's definitely, that's disingenuous. I think that CCP is filled with incredibly competent developers, designers that are getting better and better at their job every single day, understanding a system that literally no one understands. Like, that's one of the things that I think that us as a player base could really use an opportunity to kind of sit back and remember, which is that this is not an exact science. No one has ever constructed something like this before, and it's very easy for myself or somebody else to be like, hey, why don't you just do this thing? It'd be great. But we don't, you know, I don't have to think about the exact design hours in order to make it happen. I don't need to think about how to make it happen or, you know, what obstacles are going to be needing to be brought down. I don't need to think about what else is in their timeline. I don't need to think about what their marketing people are saying or where their other, you know, their higher five-year goals or whatever. I don't need to think about all that stuff. I can just be like, hey, you know what would make exploration really cool? If you totally revamp the Sisters of Eve to be like this, you know, and everybody's like, oh, you're great. But... you know, as people who are building the game, like, that process has a lot more reality to it. And there's a lot of things that we don't get to understand because we couldn't, because we're just the public. And remember, the public is always stupid, right? Well,
that's the fun thing about EVE versus other games that I've noticed is, like, yeah, you'll see a lot of, like, other MMOs where people are like, well, why don't you just do this thing and it'll be so much better? And other games are like, okay, let's do that. And it's like, oh, that's a terrible idea. And then they do it and it actually is a terrible idea and everything dies. So it's, but I find that in EVE or on EVE posting places, which are plentiful, you know, people are always like, try this thing, do this thing. And everyone's like, no.
Well, first of all, we don't just have the public. If you remember, we have a player-elected organization that gets to see a little bit behind the curtain on issues like this.
That is correct. And so let's go back to that, actually, which is that one of the complaints that I levied, or one of the things I levied, was that during the course of the war, we also had a CSM election. And I think that thanks to the heightened political kind of stature that we had during the war... that had a huge influence on what, on how that experience played out. And one of the things was, You know, there were a few people that were elected that were kind of a surprise. There were a few people that were elected that were considered to be kind of a joke, and almost even a joke at best and sabotage at worst, right? You know, there's this really interesting narrative about how broken the CSM was. And then the election happened and the new people got elected and everybody's like, oh, PL has taken over, blah, blah, blah. And then silence, almost complete silence about the CSM. And so that's, of course, troublesome because the threat was that CCP might be just shuttering the CSM altogether. So if that's true, well, then what would that look like? Well, maybe you just wouldn't hear anything about them. Maybe that's what's going on. And that's and so I presented that as like, well, you know, we haven't heard very much from the CSM. We don't know what's going on with all of this stuff going on. We do know that it was in jeopardy as of the CSM 10, and now we just haven't heard anything. And thankfully, I have been vocally corrected by numerous people, most of the CSM. Apparently, the best way to get contacted by your CSM people is to write a public article about how they're not doing anything. But it turns out that Jin'taan, you have, or sorry, I mispronounced that, but Jin, you have been keeping up your own minutes this whole time. And I'm totally a jerk for not finding it in myself before saying that you guys haven't been doing it. And I freely admit that. So why don't you talk about kind of what's been going on and what you've been doing?
Well, I don't know specifically what you want me to talk about because I could talk about quite a lot. I could talk about the interactions that we're having with devs kind of on a day-to-day level where we're discussing specific minor things with them, or we're talking about kind of our philosophy behind balance or like little changes that we want, or well, you know, stuff of that nature, which I obviously can't talk about because of NDA, sadly. Uh-huh.
Yeah, I don't want to even get you close to an NDA breach because that's like, you know,
that's just all the way bad. Let's not
Be, that would be useless. So yeah, let's get the CSM to talk. Okay, now breach your NDA. Like, that would be counterproductive. So
that's what we call the Manfred Sidious approach.
Shots.
I'm going to let that one sink in.
Yeah.
All right. So, all right. I guess my first question is, I'm going to just be the most direct. Is the CSM in crisis, in your opinion? How are things going in the CSM?
I believe the CSM is certainly at a crossroads. There was something that we talked about in chat before I went for my little pre-podcast nap about proactive and reactive CSM. And there's definitely a lot of debate, even internally within the people who are elected, as to what the CSM should be. Should we be a reactive kind of body that exists to take CCP's feedback, or take what CCP's done, and then provide unto that kind of the player perspective on it, and be a, you know, effectively a organization that is utilized by CCP? Or should we be being proactive? Should we be talking to CCP directly and trying to force them to do things, or trying to get meetings with specific teams and looking into the roadmap and trying to see what's coming and intercepting things and all that sort of more political nuance? And that's been kind of a key part of the issues within CSM 11, in my opinion, because we have a lot of people who, whilst they do have their own opinions, they're waiting for the right time to express them. They're waiting for, okay, now we can talk about this issue. And whilst that is definitely good, and you need a lot of people like that in the CSM, because you can't have 14 people who are trying to get things sorted out, because that would end terribly. And that's effectively what I think that one of the problems was with CSM 10. Is that you had too many competing leaders trying to push the CSM in all sorts of different directions.
So, and also, just quick for clarity, have you had any of your summits yet?
No, our summit will be in September 12th to September 15th. I am, in fact, flying out on September 11th, which I'm sure is a great omen that could not have any possible negative connotations.
So is that the summer summit? I thought there was, like, a summer and a winter, and...
They normally, they were thinking about doing it in May, effectively, was the original intent, but we and CSM 10 came together and went to them with the decision that We're not going to do it in May because there is no need for us to do it in May.
Fair enough.
We wanted to be able to go there and talk about things like citadels. We wanted to go there and talk about things like the capital rebalance. And if we'd gone in May, that would have been way, way too fresh, and we wouldn't have had any kind of reasoned perspective on it.
That's fair.
So, yeah, I've got to thank CSM10 for that, because they did the majority of the legwork to getting us to that decision. So CSM10 isn't a complete failure, but, you know.
Oh, I don't think anybody suggested that it was.
There are plenty of people who suggest that it was, but
that's
not fair, and it's just they're doing that thing that we do. Well, CSM's useless, whatever, because people like to make that accusation all the time.
I think that one of the things that CSM10 was obviously good at was communicating with the player base, because we knew a lot about what was going on in their world, whether or not it was good or bad that we knew. And I think that what's interesting is that CSM 11 reminds me way more of like CSM 7 or 8, which were very effective CSMs. They just weren't very public facing to us until kind of later on. So at any rate, I guess my other question would be, do you feel like CCP is respecting you? I think that one of the biggest concerns that were levied, and this is not just a CSM 10 thing, like this has always been kind of the big challenge, the march forward of CSM, is to get CCP to deeper and deeper respect for CSM. And I think that CSM 10 might have hurt that, but who knows? So would you say that CCP is respecting CSM? Do you think that they're allowing you? You're saying that you're debating proactive versus reactive, but how do you feel that the atmosphere from CCP is?
I definitely feel like it depends on the team specifically. It obviously depends on the people who are in charge, how much they want to involve the CSM. But I'd say overall we're given quite a deal of respect. You know, I can't really say anything bad about it. It is what it is. Like, if I come out here and scream, you know, we're not getting enough respect, what's that going to do? What we are is we are people who are here to push CCP in what we think is the right direction, and it's simply their job to decide if that coincides with the direction they at the end of the day want to go. But to answer your question more directly, yeah, I feel like we're given enough respect.
And do you feel that CCP Guard and CCP Logibro, who's the new kind of coordinators at the end of CCP 10, they changed from CCP Lilu to CCP Guard and Logibro. Do you feel that Guard and Logibro are embracing? I mean, like, those two guys are incredibly proactive, good community members. Are they?
Yep.
Are they? How is your experience dealing with them directly?
It's actually the having talked to CSM10 about CCP Lilo, I'd say it's a drastic improvement, as harsh as that may sound. Obviously, effectively, what the Logibro and Guard have taken is they've taken the thing of, well, we'll leave you in the chamber. If you need anything, you can come to us. And that's probably the best way they could have done that, because it does incentivize us actively talking to individual devs rather than going through one line of communication. And I think that's best exemplified by the producer chats that we are able to have every month. This is something that CSM10 heavily lobbied for and got introduced during the CSM, where every month we will talk directly with the producers of many of the major teams involved in CCP. So that's people like 5-0, Teams of Matters, Astro Sparkle, all those kind of teams. I know those names don't really mean much and they shift around a lot, but effectively that means like people who are in charge of PvE, people who are in charge of sandbox content, people who are in charge of the UI, people who are in charge of even sound and lighting and visual design. And then we go over them what they've been doing in the past, you know, couple of weeks or whatever, and we will talk about that and we'll see if there's anything that we would like that we can build in. They ask us if we have any suggestions regarding things or any feedback regarding things that have just launched. And it's a super communicative little platform. I'd say it's definitely the most important meeting, barring the summit, that CSM has been involved in probably a long time.
So I think that's awesome. I'm really glad to hear that. I think that it's good for me to hear that the CSM is happy with their communication, because I don't know if I've ever heard that before. Like, universally, it's always been incredibly antagonistic, and I think that, or at least it has sounded to be in varying degrees of either antagonistic or apathetic, I should probably say more correctly. So to hear you saying that they're being responsive and respectful is incredibly, it gives me hope. Because really, you are at a crossroads, right? Like, you could just say, oh, well, the CSM is useless and therefore will not be, who cares? Or you can be like, well, we've got these 15 people who've been elected. I mean, 14. on this, 14 people. You know, on the lowest level, that's awesome, right? That there is this whole process of a CSM. Even if you guys never did anything, just having a video game have this voting structure in it is another quirk that makes Eve cool. So it's good even on that level. But the fact that people are finally trying to figure out, okay, you know, let's make use out of this. Let's try to have a positive interaction. That's very hope creating.
So I did have a question though, because Noisy Gamer brought it up. He said, "Oh yeah, the CSM has been super active. Let me go check the CSM page." Oh wait, the last thing to be said and updated was the election results. And I think you mentioned it before that there's other places for people to see information about kind of what's going on. And I know you talked about them in the chat. I don't know if you want to talk about them out loud here, other places for people to actually see what's going on at the CSM, because it seems like people complaining are people that are having a hard time for whatever reason finding where that information is to be found.
Yeah, I think some of that is partially our fault, and I have publicly said that, you know, I apologize for that, and Mr. Hyde helped lay everything out. But part of that is just that the people who are elected aren't people with big online presence. We aren't Jester Trex, we aren't Sugar Kyles, we don't have a blog with a lot of coverage. Like, I'm personally a very, very big believer in that we should be a politically neutral entity as the CSM. We shouldn't be arguing for one person's case, and we certainly shouldn't be doing something like, I don't know, putting out the meeting, you know, the weekly reviews on CZ or TMC or EVs24. But obviously people have made it appear clear to us that they don't want to have to seek out this information. They want it presented directly to them. So we're going to work on that. Like, I already do an attendance sheet with weekly updates where I kind of go over what we talked about in that week. I know it's very hard to follow, and I know it's not the ideal way of doing things, perhaps, but I'm not a talented blogger. I'm not a very emotive writer. It's something that I struggle with. So what I'm doing what I can. The problem is that we just don't have this... Can I just backtrack a second?
Of course.
I know a lot of people talk to us and saying, well, you were on all these podcasts before, you were talking everywhere. Yeah, that's because people came to us and were like, you need to be on the show, you need to come talk to us about the CSM, you need to tell us about your plans. And that's awesome, that's what we need. We are very, very busy. We recently just compiled a document of feedback for Team Astro Sparkle regarding the Shadow of the Serpent. We had like an infinite amount of articles, a ton of good posts, our own thoughts, kind of laying out everything, and we made sure to preface that with the fact that we think the feature is a great idea. It's a massive step in the right direction, and we really enjoyed it. Just saying what we could do to make it better in the future, and that's the kind of thing that the CSM is working towards here. We can't realistically do that and find out every podcast and try and schedule dates for that. I'm imploring you guys, if you want a CSM on your podcast, on your show, you want us to write a little thing for you, just ask us. We are here to help you. We are members of the community, but we are not directly community facing until people make us that. If you want to hear from the CSM, ask the CSM what they're doing and they will tell you.
So in the spirit of asking, is there a place we can look? Or is it more just word of mouth right now? Kind of you guys talking in places, or is there places where things are already written where people can actually see kind of what you guys are thinking and saying and doing?
I don't think there's any one place where we do that. The thing is, the communication of the system is very, very distributed, unfortunately. The only person with, like, a direct community outlet would be Bobmon, and he's been on holiday for the past month. He's been teaching kids about something, I don't know.
Well, that's exciting.
Yeah, like I said, there's the meeting attendance sheet with LinkedIn minutes. I will put that in the chat now, actually.
You might get banned for it, but I will undo it.
Let me just find it. It's in the Jitter Park speakers corner.
Can you throw it in TeamSpeak so I can link it out?
Yes, I can.
In TeamSpeak. If you link it in Skype, all the videos will get screwed up, and I have to fix it. And ugh.
So I guess my NDA skirting question is, you know, you've
Danger
obviously
zone.
Had access to seeing some things, probably not as much as after the summer summit. But with all of your interactions, with all of your briefings and everything, on a scale of negative 10 to 10, where, like, negative 10 would be grave concerns for the future of the game and CCP is totally off kilter, to positive 10 being like, guys, just hang tight, like, wait 2 weeks and you will see the craziest thing you've ever seen. Like, where do you feel your feelings about the game is right now on that spectrum?
All right, so I'm going to preface this with the fact that I'm a cynical and generally pessimistic asshole.
Well, I mean,
I always
British.
Yeah, that's one way to sum it up.
And the fact that I'm in a dressing gown and on a podcast at 2 a.m. Because I've got nothing better to do with my life, apparently. But no, I would say it's at about a zero. I currently feel that Eve's treading water, almost. And I know that's not a hugely popular opinion, but I don't feel that Eve is dying. I don't feel that it is growing either. I feel that it is just, it's staying the path, and I think it can do better than that.
Do you think
that's the community's fault or CCP's fault, or a little bit of both?
A little bit of both, definitely.
Well, not just fault, but, like, do you feel that the atmosphere or the CCP that you see is capable of pulling it back, is capable of navigating these troubling times?
You're killing me here, man.
All right, moving on.
No. Go. I will answer that question. Just give me a second to think. I definitely think the CCP has it within their ability to undo the damage that has been done by the community that has rendered the game somewhat stagnant right now. I think that there are a lot of problems that are caused by existing mechanics that were designed and implemented by CCP, and I'm not just talking about things like Phoebe and Fuzzy Solve and things like that. I'm talking about, like, general balancing decisions, like the balancing trends towards greater and greater EHP, which I know a nominate specifically has brought up as a huge concern, which led to a very interesting little anecdotal thing where me and him were discussing balance philosophy going back to when he thought the game was best balanced, which was in 2005 during the era of long-range battleships being the primary doctrine for most of EVE Online. And he asked me if I remembered that and if I thought it was better than it is now, and I had to remind him that I was 9 at the time and therefore did not know.
Yeah, I did not play then either, so I don't know. Yes. But I think, we talked about this last week though, Ash, where people always in EVE have a nostalgia for the things that came before. Like, people look at what's going on now and they go, oh, but it was so much better back in the day. Wars, big wars were so much better back when it was... I don't even know the hell is their name? Bob?
Dominion?
Or whatever. Yeah. Those were the best great wars. And, you know, everyone always talks about it. EVE was better
before. To be fair, those wars were very, very different to the way it is now. In the same way that doctrines are very different, and FCing is very different, and even NOSEC leadership is very different. You're no longer about cutting a very, very specific character. It's about how you can leverage your current position, and that's probably been one of the biggest changes in EVE long term, is the fact that people, like, the only existing I guess character that is in charge of an alliance right now is the Mitanni, and that's why he's experiencing some of the issues, I think.
I will agree with you there. So I have a question that kind of going back to the article and talking about that a little bit for you, Jin, is there any kind of part of the article that stuck out to you where you think that Ash kind of has a point or that you think he needs to be expanded on? Or do you think most of it's just, oh no, Eve's dying, crying, everybody freak out?
He certainly had some great points in that. Like him talking about the CSM spurred a Reddit thread that kind of got us to talk more. Like I said, there's a reason I'm on this podcast, although I was talking to Matterall before this all happened, because I actually really like this podcast. I'm happy to be on it. I enjoy serving on podcasts. It's very entertaining to listen to people's opinions and kind of talk about things.
I just want to hear some positive stuff. We've done a lot of Ash, your article was bad. Let's hear good stuff about Ash's article.
Well, to be fair, again, it was an article that was specifically written almost with the hopes of being proven wrong, right? Because it was a moment of pessimism or kind of fear and despair, as it were, as I see, you know, like,
fear, you know, the behaviors of the eternal optimist.
Yes, the behaviors of war should not be the same behaviors as the behaviors of peace, and Eve does require both. Especially as we're entering into the second half of this year, which is supposed to have a more industry focus. And one of the great things is that actually right now on our Eve, there is like one of the top posts is basically saying that we need a revamp of PvE content. And I was so blown away because I opened it up like waiting for people to be like, oh, Eve is just, or PvE is just is per hour. Why are you doing that anyway? It's just, you know, it's just PvP, the game is for PvP, which are the arguments that I've seen time and time and time again in the last year. But when I opened it up, everybody was like, no, this is really hurting the game, and you know, we need to do this stuff. And so seeing people say that and seeing this energy that where people realize that PvP answers are not the only answers that Eve needs now. Like PvP solutions will only go so far. That ultimately the game itself has to be interesting even when there is nobody else to fight.
Well, right. Wars are great. Wars are fine. They're fun. They create content. But what do you do in the in-between? Most people quit. But, and you know, I was one of those people.
Most people.
I will say a lot.
Okay. Sorry.
I will amend my, because when I say most people, I think of all the people that I knew that quit, and that was most of the people at Eve I know. I always have to rein myself in when I make that claim, because I know it's not quite true. So I apologize for that. But, you know, when I think of a lot of people, they go, oh, war and PvP are the only thing, but I know that when the Fountain War ended for us, we pulled back and did something that I was like, I don't really know if that's interesting to me, but there aren't really many alternatives and I don't know what to do because they're not all that fun. So I know that if PvE were a little different, if there were something else to do, something more interesting to pull me in, I might not have quit and I might actually still be playing.
Right.
Sorry.
No, man, you're the important one. Go.
Yeah.
I'm definitely not important. I'm just a figure. But what I was going to say is that you have to remember, first of all, when you talk about PvE, that 70% of the game, full stop, is in high sec. That's a huge number, and CCP really has to take that into account when they talk about anything regarding PvE. But I really do get what you're talking about. I really do think that, as I said in that Reddit thread, I believe that the PvE needs a complete and utter revamp in the next 2 years, or bad things are going to happen to the game, because there will not be a solid foundation from the rest of the game to build upon. As I've talked, I don't know if I've ever actually publicly talked about this, but I don't see Eve as a progression system. It is not, you go to high sec, you wait there for a couple of years, you go to low sec, you do some things a couple of years, and you go to null sec or wormholes. It's definitely not that way, because people enjoy different things about the game. Some people enjoy the empire building of null sec, or the smaller, more, you know, almost exploration, frontier ship gameplay and the challenges that come with wormhole. Some people like the feeling of being a big bad pirate man in LoSec, or some people like the idea of fighting for an existing empire and role-playing in faction warfare LoSec, and some people just like going for an hour a week and ratting or missioning in some Kaldari system, and that's perfectly fine, and you need to have a spot in all of the game for that to work, because Eve is so, so intricately connected that if any one part of it is broken, it affects the rest of the game very meaningfully. Because if people aren't enjoying Nullsec, then the people in High Sec and the people in Low Sec don't have anyone to threaten them effectively. They're not being competed with. They're not getting that kind of Eve is other people. Eve is not, you know, a static game. It's not a static PvE experience. It's your interaction with other people, be it direct or indirect.
So when you're saying, sorry, Ash,
having High Sec be interesting does not take away from Nullsec. What that does is it means that more people that come to High Sec enjoy it, and then they enjoy the game more, and so they're part of it for longer, and then maybe they'll go on to go do something in Nullsec, maybe they'll go on to do something in Low Sec. I actually started almost immediately in Nullsec, which was terrible for me.
Yep.
I don't know about you, but it was the worst experience ever. And I spent some time in High Sec, but I really spent a lot of I've spent most of my time in Low Sec. And so there's part of me that thinks that maybe one of the next things I want to do is just move to High Sec and start a mission running corp, just because, you know, it's the idea of empire building, you know, square one. Like, how do I find, you know, like in Aetheron, we have a pretty good system, but now the question is, how do we find the correct people to expand our group? Because we're focusing more or less on, like, can we get just raw numbers, and more like, hey, we have a club, right? We like each other in this club. We all kind of know each other now. It's more than just who fleets with who. So how do we find the people that we want in our club so that we can expand to being the correct size to be able to meet our goals? And one of the ideas that's been kicking around is, why don't we create a High Sec mission running corp and just help out new players, and or, you know, even a mining industrial corp to buy back ore, so that way we can find cool people and enable new players and maybe bring them in deeper into the game as we can, you know. It's something that I haven't done in the game, and it might be something I'm interested in doing. But the point is that Eve is about mattering, right? Eve is about trying to make your actions matter. And there's a lot to PvE that could matter, but the problem is that, like, they're kind of, in my opinion, being too loose about it, too light about it. Like, you know, all of the holiday content is appearing all throughout space. There's less and less focus on standings, which standings are literally your record with people, right? You know, like, there are very easy ways to make PvE dynamic and interesting and more than just ISK per hour, but only if we can believe that that's possible.
Well, it's hard to go from being a null and being like, I shoot this other entity, and that matters because I'm effectively fighting something for a reason. I'm killing the other people because they made us angry, or made somebody angry, did this thing to one of my corp mates and it pissed me off, so I should, therefore we should start a war and we should fight them. When I go back to, like, Low Sec and High Sec, or I go ratting or mission running or whatever else and make money, it's like I'm doing this thing because I have to. Not because it's interesting, not because I find it super dynamic, but because I need to have ships. So I guess what I'm trying to say, Ash, is that I agree with you. It'd be more, I might be more enticed to do it and do it longer instead of just burning out on Nullsec and quitting for a while, of going to do something different because it's interesting and it makes a difference or it matters.
Right. So I have a concept that I like. Oh, sorry.
Go, Jin.
Yeah, I was just going to take that in a circle because I wanted to come back and comment on all that. First of all, I'm very sorry if I gave the impression that I thought that Nullsec was more important than High Sec or something like that.
No.
That definitely wasn't what I was
No, I think we're all agreeing with that point in our own way.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Oh my god, I just had to... Yeah, go ahead. Complete brain failure.
Oh, it's alright. So one of the things I've been talking about since October is a concept that I refer to as emergent encounters. So the way, I mean, and I'm not saying that this is necessarily what they should do or have to do, but it's an idea of, like, where we can take the very components that we already have and make it something else. So, like, let's say we provided some other way of working with pirate factions. So let's say as a Blood Raider, you can bring them corpses of players in order to get rewards. Maybe not all the time. Maybe you have to bring different people, like unique corpses. That'd be pretty cool. You know, whatever. So that's how you become friends with the Blood Raiders. So you've turned in 100 corpses to the Blood Raiders, and now they really, really like you. You're plus 8 because you bring them all the best corpses. Well, you're traveling around in Blood Raider space, and meanwhile, 4 jumps away, there's somebody who's just ratting there, who lives there in that space, and they're ratting there, and they're a paladin, and they're negative 8. Well, with the new AI that they're building, if they do encounter level AI, well, then you have like a boss to the event. So that person's, instead of a stagnant, you know, just anom, there is a boss running the thing that's kind of testing the person. They see that this guy that's fighting him is a public enemy number one, negative 10 to Blood Raiders, because these people have been ratting there forever. And so the AI is throwing everything it got and sends out a distress signal. Well, if you're positive 8 to Blood Raiders, several jumps within a certain jump radius, you'll get a notification: Blood Raider site under attack. This is the signature, attack by a paladin. And then that's all the information that you get. And now all of a sudden, you have given purpose to being, to doing what you're doing with the pirates. You've given the pirates a feel, a theme, and a vibe. Like, Blood Raiders are now different than the rest of the pirates in some way. And you're enabling PvP and PvE to kind of flow independent, or flow together without as much barrier.
I think you're going to see some of that come through with what CCP Ghost has been talking about regarding the new player experience. He's trying to craft something that's a little more story kind of driven. And I think that's a good step in that kind of direction. Personally, right. I really do agree with that. I have never heard you lay that out before. But emergent or organic gameplay is something that I love. I love group gameplay as well. The only time I've ever really had fun PvEing is when I had to run some incursions. That was actually really interesting. I quite enjoyed doing that in LSEC. But I wouldn't do it in high sec because I'm terrible and, you know, don't worry about my sec status. But the thing I've always had going in the back of my mind is that I wanted to effectively abolish every static PvE in the game. I wanted all PvE to be organic, and I thought the Drifters were going to be a step in that direction. That's why I was so incredibly excited for them.
Me too.
Because they have their own intellect. They actually can decide to run away. They can decide to go and get more people and then come and kill you again. They can see if you have certain modules equipped to your ship and react to that. And whilst that's very rudimentary right now, I'd really love to see that iterated upon. I want PvE in EVE to be difficult, because the best part of EVE is the fact that it is so difficult. And most people might say, oh, but any AI can be exploited. Sure, but we're not talking about the very, very high end of PvE here. What I'm talking about is the low end. If someone is just playing the game casually in high sec, or if they're just, you know, they're messing about in NOSEC and they just want to do like an hour or two of ratting, what we should be doing is we should be making that in itself an engaging experience that shows off some of the great parts of EVE. And I think Nystrik's camera has frozen.
Oh, good.
So my whole thing is
I am frozen.
Oh, sorry.
I'm frozen.
Well, I was just going to say that I agree with you completely, although I'm going to correct you. I don't necessarily say that PvE has to be harder. Because in a lot of ways, you want some of the PvE to not be quote-unquote hard, but you do want it to be engaging and complex, right? You want it to be, you want it to be deep, and you want it to be educational. Like, one of the problems that I have with current PvE is that it doesn't necessarily follow the right rules. It doesn't teach you anything about the game. You can't newt or NOS, you know, like newt and NOS functions differently. Heck, today, I was in a mission, and I was just trying to target painter a dude, and it's like, this guy has a thing on it that makes it so you can't target painter it. And I'm thinking to myself, what?
Okay, but what is it and why? How do I fix it?
And then I'm like, oh, wait, maybe he's a golem, because he looked kind of like a raven. And I was like, oh, that'd be cool, because it would teach you about ECM immunity, you know, or whatever. Not that that's a thing anymore, but it was at least at one point. So, you know, and I think they kind of went back on it.
But I would never be able to figure that out.
It wasn't a golem, and I was really sad.
I would never.
You know,
ECM immunity is a thing now, by the way. They've given
right,
that back
they gave it back.
Everything, but yeah.
But my point is that, like, I feel like there's a lot of things in PvE that are kind of left on the wayside. And so not, as I said, not a lot of changes. You could even, in theory, fix the missions that you currently have and just start regularly adding new ones so that that way it's not just a completely solved problem. And you're at least taking a huge step in the right direction. Now, there are definitely larger and crazier steps that you can take, but at this point, anything would be probably pretty good.
Yeah. At the end of the day, we're not game designers, and that's something we have to understand. Also, on the UCM immunity, you can thank the CSM for that. Specifically, Noob Man and Mr. Hyde.
Did you guys... What's going on with the do you know anything about the ECM burst issue, by the way, just as an aside?
If you check the Reddit thread, you would know that I actually was the guy who pushed for them to declare that as an exploit and get it posted and get it made. You will be banned if you abuse this.
Yay! Because,
yeah, that was a pretty serious concern. And the second it hit public, we knew that that had to be sorted, because the CSM, or at least myself, we did know about it, and we had told the CCP about it before.
And that's one thing that a lot of people need to understand. Like, there's this weird narrative right now that, like, PL uses all the... I don't really want to get into all of that, because I don't know enough about it to get into it. But the idea that, you know, like, exploits, sometimes CCP, or sometimes a company will know that something exists, and... you know, they don't publish it because it's not, they don't want everybody to worry about it, or, you know, they don't want everybody to deal with it, but they're watching it very closely. So, you know, just because something isn't talked about until it blows up doesn't mean that it's not being tracked. And I think that even happened too. Like, CCP Falcon came out and was talking about it and was like, look, man, we didn't respond within 24 hours to your ticket because, you know, we don't like to have like one response here and there, and then everybody's like, oh, well, this GM told me this, this GM tells me that. Like, give them time to properly digest what's going on, and then they will give their, you know, result.
Testing, can you guys hear me?
Yeah,
Ash,
sorry,
Jin?
That was a bit of an aside, I know.
Can we just make sure that Ashterothi, Nystrik is still in the call? Can you say something?
This is great, guys.
Well, she's still streaming.
Shit's broken. Oh, I'll just let them talk.
We can no longer hear this trick, so that may be a concern.
Yeah, but we're still on. Hold on.
You guys are good. They're good.
Right, I can still hear me on the show, so.
No. Like, this trick cannot talk to us.
It's fine. I'll let them talk.
Just keep going, I guess. Fuck it. No, I love that idea. I think PvE should be. Like, I take back what I said about making it harder. I just want it to be more organic. I want it to be like, oh, you know, if you warp into a site with two cruisers in a battleship, they run away and they get their friend in a battleship to come to you, and you have like a, you know, like how capital escalation was in Wormholes. That was like that was so close to what I would love PvE and Eve to be like, but it was kind of a bit too abusable, unfortunately. So they decided rather than nerf it, they'd almost completely remove it. But you know, there are like great things that could be done with PvE, and I look forward to seeing where CCP goes for it, because I really do think that they are going to head in that direction. And kind of heading in that direction, in the direction of a second Crucible, is something that I've really been trying to push. I think that Eve needs another Crucible right now. It needs CCP to take some time and look at what they've done and really seriously iterate on it, because iteration is something that CCP has been very, very good at promising and not quite delivering on, sadly.
It's true. One of the things that I was thinking about the other day is that there's a lot of little things in the game that are wrong or require just a little bit of cleanup. And as a developer, I would like to think that a lot of these problems should be very easy to fix. And some of these are silly, like infantry in channel. Why do we still... Okay. Can you hear me?
You could probably start record. You could probably start a recording like straight up now, like a local recording, and rip the audio from that and just blend it. It wouldn't be ideal, but you could probably do it. So I'd recommend you start. Okay.
Can you hear me? Radio check. Hello.
Can't we rip it from the copy on the stream as well?
Yeah,
maybe?
We can just rip it from the stream. Yeah. Where were we when we got cut off? Well, okay, maybe the listeners will let us know where we were at in the whole discussion. But I know we were kind of talking about PvE and what was possible. But I kind of wanted to ask, going to the Summer Summit again, obviously NDA can't talk to you about kind of what CCP is showing you or what anything that preparation is. But what about you? What is your... obviously you had a platform or you got elected from a position. What do you hope, if there's anything that you can get done during CSM or during the summit, what are you hoping to achieve?
There's a lot of things. There's a lot of things I want done. And the thing is, there's going to be a difference between what I talked about on my platform and what I end up thinking is the most necessary thing to push at the summit, sadly. Obviously there are things that I want to do specifically. I want to do a lot of little things. I want to do things like increase the amount of standing slots that are available. I want to create a better UI for logistics and mix in with that better feedback for logistics. I want to make eWAR more easily recognizable and understandable to players who are using it, because obviously that's a role we put a lot of new players in and it's not entirely understandable from their perspective what effect they're having. And I'd really like it if we could put that into the game to a greater degree. But on top of that, what I'm really going there with is that kind of idea that iteration is key. Iteration needs to happen in the game. And I really think that it's something that I'm going to be there to talk about. And it's kind of the... What I hope is the overarching theme of the summit is the fact that CCP, you've been doing an amazing job with a lot of these features, but they're not quite finished yet. You need to do some things to get them to a point where you have a solid foundation to build new features from. And that's something CCP has historically not achieved with any regularity. And it's something I hope CSM can push towards.
They've been historically poor on the upkeep portion of things.
Well, like when I think of all the stuff that was supposed to come out, you know, like right now they're doing it really, really slowly and we're still looking at a half finished system that is supposed to be mostly done by now, but some of it still feels like, okay, but it still doesn't feel quite finished yet.
Well, I'm actually less concerned about stuff like that because that's like development.
I know that they're working on it still. Like, and things, yeah, I get
but
that.
I think that the bigger problem would be things like, somebody will give me crap about it, but you know, the secret code, right? The secret code was completely abandoned. You know, the AI has been delayed indefinitely. We were told that the hope was a four-way faction war by the end of the year, and that was last year. So there are a lot of things that we haven't actually heard that much about. There are a lot of things that we know have become abandoned. And historically, prior to CCP Seagull, that was probably the number one biggest problem with CCP, was that it was just, it was beyond a joke about how badly CCP maintained previous systems, right? Like Faction Warfare would get a revamp and then would get nothing for 3-4 years, you know? And they've gotten a lot better about it. But you're absolutely correct. There is a lot in the game that would require what I hope to be, and this is actually what we were talking about before the comms went down.
Sorry.
No, that it was good because it led us right back into it. there's a lot of things in the game that could easily be fixed, or at least should easily be fixed, should be easy to fix, that I think would overall improve the quality of the game. Like, for instance, on every chat channel, there is a infantry in channel, right? Well, that seems really simple, but in a world in which somebody is trying to learn everything, this symbol, this thing exists in the UI, and therefore it must be important. And so I look into what that is. Oh, that's dust. That's not even a thing anymore. So now I'm instantly in the UI in every single chat channel pointing my player towards something that sucks about the game, which is that our connection to Dust 514 doesn't exist anymore. So they should make sure to go through there and clean up that stuff to make sure that it doesn't continue to be there. There's a lot of other things within the UI, little examples of things that need to be cleaned up. One of the great things, actually, a positive side of things, is the region descriptions. We actually just got reports, for those of you, for the 10 people, or for the, sorry, the two people that care that are listening, we're getting all of the region descriptions back. It used to be that when you looked at a region, every region has a description which tells you about the thing, and you know there is this focus within the lore community to kind of let the lore be accessible, because that's another way that the universe draws you in. If the lore was digestible and not hidden and convoluted and terrible and locked behind, not that the lore is terrible, but the tools that we have to learn about
the lore is interesting.
No, the lore is fascinating.
The lore in Eve is absolutely fascinating. And
but getting at it is like pulling teeth.
Obviously, as a member of CVA, I'm a filthy role player, and I quite enjoy that kind of aspect of the game. It's something that I'm a very big fan of, and it's something I actually have talked to CCP specifically about, because whilst the CSM doesn't have any impact on the lore, and we do not get given any advance notice of any kind of lore events that are going to happen, unfortunately, RIP, I do not have the ability to be an oracle whilst I'm
Jin was like, I would plan so many things.
It's funny because when I was running for the CSM, people were like, but you can't do that because you're the lore guy. Then you'll know everything. And everybody's like, no, they don't. Like, why would the CSM know about what's coming up in the lore? That doesn't even make sense.
But yeah, I've tried to push to make... I know this is going to sound like a really minor thing, but myself and Nuria have been pushing to kind of make the CSM more canonized in the lore and also more visible in game, because
up until now
we have the CSM exists as an entity in the game. It's a known thing.
Right.
It exists. We have a role, but there's no place in the game where if you want to go and like say, oh, there's a summit going on, without using the site, how would you know about that? And I came up with the idea of maybe having a beacon or something in ULive, which is where these meetings would take place, just so that people would know that, hey, there's a summit going on, people are talking about the game, people are kind of, people are fighting my corner with CCP. That's an interesting part of the game, and it's something that if you spent your entire time in HiSec doing missions and not reading the forums, you wouldn't know about.
Well, I liked when they did the scope videos, because I'd be like, it was like, ooh, this is cool.
Awesome.
What's happening now? All stuff is happening with stuff. Like, they could do a scope video on CSM.
I'd love that.
That'd be so fucking cool.
But not just that, but I just made a video today, and usually what happens is I get super stoned and then do something and then just go off on a rant, and then I wait till I sober up and I watch it, and if it's not completely garbage, then I will do something with it.
Disclaimer, drugs are bad, don't do drugs. Okay, thanks kids, go on.
I have PTSD, it's
fine. Anyways, go on.
Yeah, so I live where it's legal anyway. So
what do I blaze it, my friend?
All right. So, at any rate, one of the things that I was very impressed by and realized is incredibly important, there's an incredibly important feature that's been added over the last several months, and unfortunately it's been mostly either ignored or potentially even reviled by the population, and it's one of those things that I really think that CCP needs to get behind and the players get behind, and it really ties into the whole thing about iteration that you were just talking about, because it's super important for it to be supported in order for it to do well, which is the in-game Jumbotron, right? So
yes,
we can now make a video and show it to people, which means player content is being projected to everyone in the game. And I don't think people have fully figured out how big of a deal that is. One of the people that I think get it are the big institutions, right? So like the PL one does a really good job of advertising it. The Imperium one does a really good job of advertising what they're doing. One of the things that I would like to see, for instance, though, is Red Frog. I think Red Frog was a huge miss. It's literally just their logo and their website. It looks just like every other advertisement of somebody trying to recruit new members. Like, Red Frog is a service. Their commercial should be about their service and should be a way of kind of educating people. So CSM candidates should have their own stuff on the Jumbotron. People should be, if we can get our creativity and exploit this medium of, well, you've got like what, 12, like 15 seconds, no audio, but you have people's captured attention because they're sitting in the station not doing anything and they've just got these visuals coming up. And it wasn't that interesting when it was just, buy glasses or buy skill injectors, but that was never the point. This is player made content being showcased to all of the players, which allowing players to figure out that there's a bigger world going on that they might want to pay attention to is like the number one historically gigantic problem in EVE.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a huge piece to it.
I cannot wait to see NullSec station specifically gain control over what's shown in their own stations. I think that's going to be a very interesting...
Propaganda everywhere!
I really hope that happens because that would be so cool.
Well, they've also
being
said
able
that,
to
you know,
choose
being...
to propagandize to your own members. That's awesome. That's just so EVE. That's
yeah,
that's
it
perfect
is.
For me.
Yeah, it is.
I want, and this goes way back to my first article when I was first dreaming about like what posses could be if they did modular posses. And I said that, when you get to somebody's empire in Null, you should feel like you're in an empire, right? Like, you should get on grid and there's all these different structures and there's statues erected and you all this kind of stuff. And they've said that they want to do this. They've said propaganda systems are coming. So, when you think about the potential of what they're working on, it is very hopeful. But this idea of us being able to broadcast messages. And the other good thing about this is, and the thing I like about it, is that unfortunately, there's kind of that darker side of EVE where people feel like they should be able to just do whatever they want, and that has a tendency to make some of our media kind of cater to the lowest common denominator, if that makes sense. But by having this veneer of Scope or whoever is managing these broadcasts has to be okay on capsuleer stations, and therefore, if somebody's out of game stuff or as much as I love the Do You Love Waffles commercial, it doesn't really work in the browser. So forcing people to think about their, or not in the browser, but in the client, thinking about people trying to sell their place in the universe to other people via this visual media, but keeping it entirely in-game is just another way of making people invest in the universe itself. And that is crucial.
I have this image of, this poor, lower high-sec guy who's like, I don't know what this is. I'm going to go into NullSec for the first time. There's just, statues of, Mitanni everywhere. And he's like, oh, God, what is that? It's terrifying. Somebody help me. There's, plasters of Imperium. Because that's, when I think of someone who would propagandize the hell out of their space, obviously the first people I think of is the Imperium and Goons and Mitanni.
And that leads you to some great moments. Imagine if the Mitanni had anchored, I don't know, a collidable structure that was this is a statue of Mitanni, it's made out of solid, unobtainium, it sparkles with malevolence, to take a quote from Dwarf Fortress, from her third favourite game. And
well,
imagine if you then got to topple that statue. That would be a cool moment.
Yeah, it would.
No, I just can imagine jumping into Decline Now and just seeing a statue of the Mitanni flipping the bird and it spray painted on his chest false god or something,
you can vandalize the propaganda? That would be awesome.
Oh man, that's pretty fucking great. I love that idea. I don't think it's very likely to happen.
Oh God, no! Could you imagine the profanity people would graffiti onto people's propaganda? It's a terrible idea.
worse than the swearing, it's going to be the Game of Thrones spoilers. That's what's going to really get you.
I think that
vandalism probably won't be a thing, but I definitely think that people are going to take their enjoyment shooting down other people's propaganda.
Absolutely. I would love it.
But yeah, anyway, at the end of the day, we are talking like a bit pie in the sky there. I want to bring this back to the CSM and the summit, if I can.
Yes, do that.
Because it's something, a message I wanted to give out, which is that we're doing a lot of roundtables. We're doing a lot of talking to specific communities that feel that their problems haven't been addressed or that aren't represented within NullSec, because we know there's a really big popular opinion that the CSM this year is very, very null-focused. And at the end of the day, it is. Like, we are people who primarily live and operate in NullSec. Exceptions though, obviously, but that means that we don't have knowledge of certain things, and that's why I'm trying to get roundtables together. If you feel that your community isn't represented, or if you want to bring us problems, don't try and bring us solutions, please. We're not a solution orientated council. That's not what the Council of Style Measurement's ever been about. It's not about proposing solutions. It's about pointing out problems and letting CCP find the solution, and forcing CCP effectively to find the solutions to those problems.
Or at least to make them think about it, right?
So, I think that that's a really interesting point, because, you know, a lot of people who play EVE, especially the people who are very vocal, are, you know, that IT or very technically oriented or professional kind of people. And so, you know, when you work in a professional environment, you're taught to never just bring a problem. Right, you have to also come with some sort of solution to the problem. But in this case, you're just a customer, so you're not expected to have the solution. But you should just come and say, "This sucks, and this is why." Like, really well, and to articulate your argument. You know, make sure that you have, you've processed your own assumptions and all that kind of stuff, and give good feedback as to why you feel the way it is. But But yeah, I mean, ultimately, it's not our job to make the solution.
Yeah, and like one of the things I've really tried to focus on when I was pitching these kind of roundtables to people is that we're not here to find out what's wrong with a specific group. We're here to find the core consensus. We're here to find what's wrong with every group and bring that to CCP, which helps us to kind of differentiate it and make sure it's as politically neutral a message as possible.
When I started getting into game design myself, I read a very interesting story, which was about Borderlands and the way that Gearbox does their testing, because they do a lot of open testing, where basically if you live in that area, you can just go and test whatever it is that they're doing that day. And so they were testing Borderlands, and specifically they were testing just that kind of that first area. And most players have probably if you haven't played Borderlands, it's just kind of this first-person shooter, but it's more of like an action RPG. So there's like a really clever story, and there's levels and progression and all that kind of stuff. So there's these areas where the events take place, and then obviously there's areas that you traverse to get between those main set pieces. And the feedback that was given was that the area of traversal was too long, that it was too much travel time in between exciting events. And so the players were asking for them to shorten that travel time somehow. And so Gearbox did was, of course, they just added more enemies. That was completely the opposite of the feedback. People wanted it to go faster. People wanted less things to fight. People thought that the things that they were fighting was getting in the way. But by adding more enemies, what they've done is they've turned it from a travel zone to a combat zone, which means that people no longer process it as they're just trying to get somewhere. It's that they are doing something even as
fighting
they're moving.
Fighting their way there, yeah.
And so often as a tester or as a feedback giver, you have to realize that your perception is only that, your perception. And it's up to the people who are collecting the feedback, processing the feedback, and doing the design to take all these different things and figure out kind of the truth behind that. So, you know, what makes mining boring? And more importantly, if mining is boring, why are people finding it interesting? Because there are people that mine, regardless of how much we want to dismiss it. There are groups of people, there are social orders right now in game that exist because it's a bunch of people that go out and mine together and shoot the shit all day. And so if you changed mining dramatically to make it an active game or to make it more interesting for you, what you're doing is destroying their gameplay. And that's another really interesting thing to think about, especially as like we talk about things like, oh, well, they should totally change the way that missions work. Well, that is on the one hand true, but on the other hand, you know, it's a lot like
NullSec. You've got to ensure that content is still there for the people who enjoy it. I definitely agree with that.
Well, more importantly, but you have to make sure that the content, you are at least ensuring that the people who are doing what is doing right now will also continue to like what you're doing afterwards. I think that one of the problems with NullSec and the NullSec changes that happened was that they alienated the old mentality, but they didn't do very much to kind of bring in a new guard. And so I'm not sure, and again, this could totally be wrong. Maybe we're not having this problem at all, which would be great. But I feel like we're not bringing people in as fast as we need to in order to get people excited about the new system. But then again, there's all kinds of reasons why that is, and I think that that's what they're really working on right now, which is good.
Well, I mean, it's hard, though. Like, you know, it's difficult, you know, when I think of other MMOs that do people give all this feedback of, hey, you need to do this thing, you need to make it easier, you need to make it this, you need to make it that, and then they do, and they make it easier, and the people that once used to play and enjoyed the old way of doing it are like, oh, okay, I think I'm done. And I mean, Eve has a very vocal old guard versus other games, like... So I think about it a lot, and I think, how do you balance what people wanted before? Because people look back, like I said before, people look back and go, oh, that thing about Eve that was so great, Eve was only great then, it's not great now. How do you bring elements of that for people that are old guard and still make them interested? Like, that's a really hard, that's a really tall order, in my opinion.
Yeah, right, the thing is, you've got to make a synthesis of gameplay. And the problem is, you have to understand that eventually some forms of gameplay are going to die, and that's for the health of the game.
Yeah, I agree. I completely agree with you.
Think about the people who enjoyed, for example, flying slow clap fleets. If you love slow clap fleets, if that's all you logged on for, that now no longer exists. That form of gameplay is dead, and that is good, because that gameplay was just absolute toxic for the rest of the game. And I think CCP, I think a lot of people are going to eventually have to come to the, well, not a lot of people, a very few, very select minority of people are going to have to come to the realization that their gameplay is not good for the majority of people, and that's not ideal. I'm not talking about anything in particular there, by the way. I'm just thinking out loud.
It's just the idea of being amenable to changes, right? CCP makes changes and balance changes because they're thinking about the health of the game, and you have to be amenable to that. You have to understand that some fleets aren't going to work anymore because of these nerfs, and it sucks that you liked that fleet. Like, I liked Ajax, but I don't see that really anymore, but that's okay.
At the same time, I think that there's a couple points that I would say to that. First of all, the capital changes is a really good example of this, right? Mm-hmm. Because it was a dramatic change, and there's a huge controversy, and there's a lot of people that still today feel kind of out in the rain, whereas there's a lot of other people that are really excited by the changes. So it's a good example of that. But what I think needs to happen is that there is a certain point where you need to realize that maybe it isn't that you like that game style, and maybe you do, maybe there are some people, but I'm willing to speculate that there's a lot of people that would like slow cats that really like what slow cats provided, which is the ability to just crush your opponent with this kind of indefensible system, and that very nature of, like, you can't compete with them. It's the idea of, like, going back to the newbie zone and just killing, you know, level 10s when you're level 70, right?
Yeah.
So, like, yeah, that's cool and all, but if that's the thing that everybody gets to do, then it's kind of detrimental. So I think that, you know, a lot of those gameplays, people learned slow cat. No, I don't think anybody, if slow cat was just balanced with everything else, I don't think that a lot of people would choose to always use that option. It was the fact that it was effective that made people inherently like it. And the fact that it wasn't effective anymore caused them to lose, and they don't like to lose.
Well, right.
So
I'm really happy that we're coming into my wheelhouse now. We're talking about fleets. This is what I know. This is FC by trade. All that talk about PvE, not entirely sure about it. That's why we have roundtables. That's why I want people to come and talk to me and explain, you know, why, for example, I'm doing a high sec ganking roundtable. That's going to be really interesting because it's not something I've had a huge amount of experience with. But we're also doing NOSEC FC roundtable. We're doing a NOSEC leadership roundtable. We're doing a wormhole one. We're kind of trying to get in contact with as many groups and building a core consensus of problems and then bringing that to CCP. As I've said before, with the hopes of basically getting a lot of iteration done in a short period, within the CSM term, effectively, is our goal.
Make Logis visible. I agree with chat. I agree with chat. I am a Logi pilot and I want to be seen. That is my suggestion.
My specific suggestion to CCP on this issue, because we know that having logistics on kill mails currently just isn't technically viable in the system, is that they give you a pop-up when you heal someone. Because right now we've got that you take damage and you give damage, and that's all that pops up in your combat log under damage. I'd love it if we could have a pop-up that says, you repped 500 to this dude.
That'd be so helpful, because I'm like, am I doing something? Am I keeping you alive? Is it working?
Yeah, obviously, that's another point on iteration, actually, because they changed the way logistics work so that it has fall-off. But that means that the amount of rep that Logi do is no longer a static thing, and there is no way to tell how that works within the client.
Is there no way to find the optimal? Really?
No, there is, but
how do you rep, you don't know how much
returns over fall-off? Yeah. Because it's not a straight curve.
Gotcha. I'm bad at math, so go on.
Basically, it goes like optimal, fall off, and it goes like that. So you've got like a smooth curve. So obviously, it's you can't just say, oh, well, it falls along this. It's going to be roughly that. It is a very difficult thing for someone to do in their head, and that's why I want there to be more visual feedback, because if you see a number pop up, that's good. People like big numbers.
They do.
We saw that with WoW. People like numbers. They're easy to understand. They're a lot more easy to understand than trying to do trying to work out how much 1% of 1% of someone's shields are and how much of that you're doing.
I will say it was always really satisfying to see people's, you know, seeing people's bars get low as a healer in WoW and then see them pop back up or see how much I'm healing. That was always really satisfying. Like, okay, I saved people. I was helping. That's good.
Yeah. That's at the end of the day, that's what I want to do. But, you know, that's something that I've talked to the UI team about, and they actually really liked the suggestion, but they don't know if it's technically feasible. Mm-hmm. And that's a lot of the things that are stopping these little things is that it's hard to know until you look at it if it's even possible.
Gotcha.
Because Eve has a very, very old code base.
Yeah. You were going to say something, Ash, and I kind of cut you off there. Sorry about that.
I'm not 100% sure. I was just trying to say that, the problem is, and this is true in a lot of ways, there's very little mechanisms within the game right now to let you know what your ship's current capabilities are. You can look at stats, which tell you kind of the default of things, but you know, it's very difficult for you to get feedback about how things are going in the moment. This was a big concern of mine with like tracking disruption when it came to the, and although they're working on these kinds of things because they had the weapons, like the weapons effective tracking was going to be added, and then it kind of wasn't, if I remember correctly, when they did the new tactical map, they were going to have tracking on your weapons, but I think that they didn't make that didn't make it into the release. I don't know what's happening with that, but it'd be nice if we had more. There's this idea of depth versus complexity, and depth means more choices, more things to do. Complexity means more things that the user has to have in their mind in order to make simple decisions. And so I think that there's a lot of things in Eve, in particular with the UI, that makes Eve more complex than it needs to be.
The UI
without
in
necessarily
general?
Making, yeah, exactly. Without necessarily making it more shallow. I think that when people say, oh, you're dumbing down Eve, you're making Eve less complex, what they're really concerned about is making Eve less deep.
Well, it's funny because the first thing that I remember upon getting into NullSec and joining an alliance and actually doing stuff with them is they were like, okay, so your UI, the thing that pops up on the top right that tells you where everything is and how far it is and all that stuff, that's useless. Download this one, use this one instead. So, like, that's something that always makes, like, you go into the game and it's like, okay, here's how you tell where things are and what they're doing. It's not really that great, so here, we have this modified one that you should use instead. And I feel like that adds an element of, okay, well, if everyone else is telling me to use something different, what about what is there is not working? Why isn't it working? Why isn't it being changed? And I know that it got it... I know it got changed a bit, but I'm not sure. Anyways, go
ahead. Go ahead. I just wanted to say that the OV is pretty great. Actually, I quite like it. But then again, I'm someone who's used it for 8 years, so I'm kind of used to it.
So here's an interesting thing about design and behavior and human social engineering, which is what a lot of these kinds of games are all about. So what's interesting is that if you leave it slightly terrible, then but give players the ability to teach each other the correct way to do it, which is a good example of the overview, right? What ends up happening is that you're basically just creating a notion for somebody to take on a mentor role, which is this kind of the beginnings of the social glue that makes Eve work, right? So the idea of like, oh no, your overview is terrible, use this one, you know, as long as the overview, the terribleness of the overview is only kind of relative, as long as, you know, you can actually make an overview that's very basic. A good example is like in Hearthstone, right? In Hearthstone, you're just given a deck, and it's a crap deck, but at least it's a deck. You don't have to worry about trying to learn what every single card is. You can just jump straight into it. So in the same way, the overview needs to give you exactly what you need to have in order to be a good new player. Right. And so then when you find another player to mentor you, they can go, hey, by the way, here's the secrets to unlock it. And now you've initiated a social order, which has started to become trust and leadership and all these kinds of things. And it seems very, very petty and it seems very, very simple. But it is part of that indoctrination process. Right. You got to think about it. If you join a NullSec alliance, there's the idea of, you got to move your stuff. You got to be introduced to the logistics. Sure. You got to be brought into Jabber. You got to be added into the stuff. And not only does that help create the make the alliance run, but it really does drill into the head of a person that they're getting into something that's bigger than them, right?
Sure.
The idea that there is an orientation and there is necessarily an orientation really drives home that fact that you are becoming part of a group of people. And so I think that there is still a value with leaving things for the players to kind of show each other. But at the same time, it needs to be functional enough that somebody isn't turned away without that kind of insider knowledge.
Right, but that goes back to my problem of, sure, that's great and I agree to an extent, but like I remember coming in as a new bro going, what the fuck is going on my screen right now? What? No.
Yes.
And I walked away! I walked away!
I think that you guys are approaching this from the wrong perspective. I think you guys are approaching this from the overview being bad, when in reality it's explaining the overview is bad. And that's
I'll agree with you there.
I really, really hope is covered in the new player experience which is being worked on. Because I'm not a fan of opportunities. I think that they are basically inferior to the old career agents, but that's because I'm nostalgic as fuck. I don't actually know. I'm not a new bro. I can't tell you guys that. But I really, really do think that they are working towards making a tutorial that is in-depth. I haven't seen much of it, but they are going to be talking to us about it at the upcoming summit. So that's going to be really, really interesting. And we will get to give input on things that we think new bros absolutely must learn to be able to play the game. I don't know how much I can talk about what we've done in preparation for that, unfortunately. But we have been doing some specific preparation. I know Zanuri has been very interested in it. He's actually been reading a lot of psychological books specifically. And forwarding specific chapters about
being designed. Did he have his brain scanned?
No, he has not had his brain scanned yet.
Let's see if he's got the vessels, whatever CCP ghosts, the whole thing. No, I do too. I love him. I want to hear more from him. But I think that all of that is extremely important. Like how we bring people in, how we explain stuff is pretty much the key that we need to solve to before we move over. But I will again, I'm the one that's having to vote. I feel kind of good because people are talking about PvE like it makes sense. So I get to voice all the things that I've quietly held true. But I don't actually not like the opportunities system. I just think that it's being used for the wrong thing. Like, achievements have value, and there are ways to use achievements, but you don't necessarily want all of your achievements to be, you know, front-loaded at the very beginning. That isn't how you run a tutorial. Achievements help move you through a tutorial, but there also needs to be more stuff for other people later on, right? So there needs to be a tutorial. There needs to be achievements to reward throughout the process of the tutorial, and then you can use that for other stuff too, right? So again, yeah. This goes back to that whole notion of make Eve matter. If you use achievements as a record, you know, if Eve is supposed to matter, if my actions in Eve should matter, then why does it make sense that more of my actions in World of Warcraft is recorded than in Eve? I want my legacy to be known. I want a rap sheet that shows what I've done. I want an opportunity to tell me exactly how many Blood Raiders I've killed or how many corpses I've scooped or, you know, whatever. You know, let me build my legacy.
We actually had a discussion with that with our team Astrosparkle, the team behind the Scope Network, on the subject of achievements recently. Steve brought up a great point talking about the difference between participatory aspirational achievement. I got there in the end.
Aspirational.
But yeah, like talking about what's the difference between, okay, you've done the very basics of the game and it's good to reward for that, but you also want to then give people aspirational ones, like where's the opportunity for I sat in my first capital, where's the opportunity for I completed my first level 4 mission, where's the opportunity for I made my first ship with ore I mined myself, where's the first opportunity for I made my first tech 2 ship, you know, where is all that?
It'd be cool. I got the killing blow on a thing or
yeah,
something.
Yeah, I got
That'd
my
be
first
great.
Kill. That's actually a thing, actually, right now. I think that's called the cycle, the vicious cycle chain of achievements, opportunities.
And then, of course, you can take that logical extreme and have things like feats of strength. So what if every single person that was on grid when Jameel was killed got a special achievement at that moment that only they got that marked everyone that was there
a badge of glory. Like, people that got old titles in WoW were like, look at this title I got before all you other people did things. I'm so cool. Look at me. And I mean, I know that sounds lame, but it is cool. Good.
So the thing that you guys are forgetting is that we have a system like that already in the game called the medal system. And how many people check medals? No one, because they're completely worthless right now.
Well, actually true. Like in Faction Warfare, each faction has now gotten a medal. Like I have the Galente medal, and I showcase it. You know, I'm really proud of it. But the point is that every single time that comes up, it is a chore. Like literally to the point where they've said no more. Like each empire has gotten it once and that's it, and it was always a big deal. But I think that if you front load it, you're right, a lot of these mechanics already exist, so if you thought about it, they could blend these systems together to make it work. But on the other hand, it goes back to it's all legacy code, so who knows how easy that would be.
I hate to keep banging on about iteration, but that's the thing that I think is the most important about the game. I think that if we talk more about, hey, you have most of these systems here, they just need to be blended together and pushed a bit more to the forefront, you know, you can still package that as a new feature. You can still talk about that as something in something that's advertised,
advertisable.
Is that a word? I don't think that's a word.
It's fine. It gets the point across.
You know, if you change the way that, for example, let's say we change the way that Tech 3s work. We completely revamp them. We make them into something that you can, I don't know, do crazy, like absolutely crazy bullshit. Like you refit from modules in your cargo instantly, and oh, it's cool. You can do whatever you want. It's, you know, that's a really dumb idea. Please don't do that, CCP. That would be awful. You know, if you did something like that, you can still market that. You can still say that, you know, that all these systems have been changed. The Galante Federation has released their new Proteus, and it's got all these cool the Proteus Mark II that's got all these cool features. The people who you're trying to bring into the game don't know that the Proteus Mark I is exactly the same as the Proteus. It no longer exists, effectively. Yeah. What you know, that's cool. You can still market revamps. You can still market big changes in gameplay without it feeling like it's a detrimental thing, in my opinion.
I agree.
But I agree.
Alim, I don't know how to pronounce names. That's a thing of mine.
Member of my alliance, actually.
So Alim asked the question, what is the point of achievements? And again, I want to go back to the idea of it's a permanent record. Like, yeah, great. There's certain ones that are like, oh, I've killed this many people. Ha ha ha. But on another hand, like, it does show what you have and haven't done, right? And again, you know, they've always
said that
it gives
you goals to aim for.
It's supposed to matter.
Well, to that point, if you have kind of a visible signature of that, it also shows what you're most proud of, which I think is also a very interesting concept. Imagine if you had, I don't know, let's make a new medal system. Let's make like a trophy room. What would you put? What would you say your one greatest achievement is that you would put in your personal trophy room? I want all of you to answer.
I killed
that.
A Titan day one in my corp.
So you, yeah, so
they
you
were
say,
like, everyone come out, and, yeah, everyone come out and kill this Titan. I was like, what's a Titan? And how they were cool like, it doesn't matter, just come fucking kill it. And I was like, okay, it was amazing.
How cool would it be if you could have, I don't know, in your trophy room, like a piece of that Titan, and it links to the kill now, and that's your trophy. That's your thing. That's your
great.
Equivalent of a title in the game. What about you, Ashterothi? What are you most proud of doing in this game?
I think that I would probably have my the Galante War Medal for taking the whole war zone.
Yeah, so you
because
have
taking part of that was a big thing.
And yeah. In a trophy room, and it's like, I got awarded this for the Galante Federation because I took part in this massive effort to cleanse the war zone. You know?
And this goes back to the story thing, right? Like, yeah. You know, they want us to be building stories. And what the way you build stories is you give people goals and journeys and the ability to reminisce upon it, which I think that a lot of those things do. Like, I actually just got back into WoW about a week ago, just kind of checking it out, and I opened up my old achievements and looked through stuff. Or even when I'm talking about people, I was like, oh, somebody was talking about the fishing achievement, and I was like, oh yeah, I've got the Dalaran coin because I spent 3 days
yeah.
doing nothing else besides just sitting there fishing out of a tiny little fountain. It was the stupidest thing
it's
in the world.
So
but you
dumb.
Know what? I've got the thing from it.
I log into WoW like probably once an expansion, and I'm like, yeah, I did all those things. That was badass. But Eve Scout brings up an interesting idea, which is one thing as corp leaders, I'm just going to read what he says. We would love to develop corp-defined opportunities and achievements, talking about kind of player-driven opportunities, achievements, and stories. That's a great way to do it. Like, hey, I'm going to set up this opportunity or achievement to go out and kill 20 of this thing, or get 100 of this, or be able to do this other thing. And like, that'd be great. For especially for new players, like, here's a set of new player achievements. Fit a ship to look like this. Fit a ship to look like that. Kill something with that ship. Like, that's an interesting idea, in my opinion.
Yeah. Like I said, you know, you probably wouldn't use those in your trophy room, but they're still a way of measuring a success. And the thing is that also helps you to tell a story. That's something that I also think is kind of not really ever been approached by CCP. There's never been an in-game mechanic that encourages people to look at other people's history, apart from, hey, check this guy's kill board, see
yeah.
if most of his ships have cynos. That's like, you know, that's a thing, but there's never been a mechanic that's specifically geared towards getting other players to interact with other players to tell specifically stories of great things that they are proud of achieving. And I think that's something that the game could use. But the thing is, at the end of the day, I don't know if that's a priority over something like a PvE remap.
Probably not.
Or Nullsec iteration, or Capital iteration, or ensuring that ship balance is more carefully maintained. And that's one of the greatest problems about being on the worst problem about being on the CSM, is that you have to face that reality every day. You have to talk to these people, and they're like, yeah, that's a great idea. but we're busy doing this one thing, and you're like, oh yeah, yeah, it makes perfect sense that that's what they're doing,
yeah,
and that that is more important than that, but you still feel bad because that thing that you were suggesting is also a good idea, and you have to understand that not all good ideas can be made, and that is probably one of the most heartbreaking things about the CSM. It's probably why most people don't do two or three terms.
I will say, to kind of put this into reality, I can guarantee you that, well, not guarantee, but I will say that the chance of me having finished the Gold Ouroboros, the having finished Shadows of the Serpent, would have increased dramatically if I had known that there would be a lasting thing that I got from it. Just the fact that there is Isk, or the blueprint that was worth Isk, or something like that, I don't care. But if there is an achievement, if I got a final piece, if I got to keep a piece of the Ouroboros or something like that, if there is a special skin that you can only get for having finished it and have that be worthwhile, or, you know, something, I probably would have gotten more. In fact, actually, I'll tell you this. If I could have gotten, like, guaranteed the Hecate skin for the Serpentis, for the Gold Ouroboros, I would have totally gotten 50,000 and not even thought about it.
Bring up something that I'm very concerned about with the Ouroboros containers, which is the fact that they are random, which is something that we weren't actually made aware of. That's one of the small failures in communication that I have experienced during the CSM. But we actually had a really good discussion off the back of that and started to talk to CCP about when things might, you know, because they didn't think that was a huge part of it, but for us that was actually quite an important distinction, whether stuff's random or not random.
Especially,
we've had a talk with them about that, and I know it's effectively analogous to a loot table, but it doesn't feel like that to the player base.
No, it doesn't at all. Especially for the Eve player base, who likes to go, I know I'm going to do and make this per hour, be able to accomplish this and get these things. Knowing that it's random adds an element of, okay, so I'm not going to actually be able to do this all the time, know for sure what I'm going to be getting kind of per hour or per minute. Because a lot of, like, when I think of Eve and what people talk about how they're making money or getting items or whatever, it's always a ISK per hour sort of. They're calculating what they're getting based on a known factor. Adding an element of unknown for Eve players is like, you're doing what now?
Well, I'm going to counterpoint that and say that there actually has been a lot of Explorer content, which is highly randomized in the game, but you work the averages in that kind of sense. I think that one of the biggest problems was that you only get those three containers, you only get the one container, and that container is random. Like, if you, for instance, loot boxes in Overwatch work because you will always get another one. So if this one that you got was crappy, then that's great. You just work on for the next one. So if
just
they made it
farming.
So that you got... Right. So it's fine if you got, like, the Gold Ouroboros could have been 50,000, and that would have been great, and it could have been random and cool and give you a vehement. And had they have just given you a bronze every 1K or every 10K, so that way you get four and then continue to get it afterwards, or however they did it, so that way you felt like your one roll was not your one roll, then I think that they would have been a lot better off. But it was just the combination of all these pieces kind of working in contrast with each other that left such a bit bad taste in people's mouth when it, which is good, which is important to note, because that means that the feature is really, really close to being really, really awesome.
Yeah, that's something we had to explain to Astrosoft, because they, when we originally talked about it, they thought we were being quite negative about it, and that's something we've learned about communication as well. Like, the CSM is really a real big learning process, and that's why it's very important that we have a couple of incumbents next year, although I probably won't be running. It's something that is a very big learning curve. You have to learn how the teams interact, or want to interact with you.
To interrupt, hold on for a second, sorry. I'm going to let you guys, like, one more comment each about kind of the topic, because we're just about out of time, so one more comment each, shorter-ish. Ashterothi, I'm looking at you. And then we'll do our sign-offs and everything. So go ahead, Ash and Jin.
Yeah, no, I was just, now that kind of blasted what I had to say, but it doesn't really matter. What I'm trying to say is that, with what you were saying, feedback is really important, because I've seen CCP... see a feature not quite work so well, and they just pull it completely, or they pull support for it completely, or they let it just rot. And that is, I think, if there's anything that CCP can do to improve the world as we move on, is to realize that leaving things to rot doesn't make things better, but finding the happiness, finding the core engagement in things, and working with the community to do that is the path forward.
My final comment will be pretty short. It's if you think the CSM isn't communicating well enough and you want to talk to us, talk to me. Like, I'm happy to go on whatever you want me on. You know, at the end of the day, the way that you want us to communicate with you is something I'm happy to help with. And also, please try and talk to us about things that you think aren't being addressed by CCP currently. And I'd be very happy to, very happy and very interested to learn about them. Other than that, I'm done. Thank you for having me on.
So guys, I just wanted to say to everybody listening still, first and foremost, I apologize for my camera and audio deciding no. I don't know why it did that, I will have it fixed so that this doesn't happen again. Matterall will be back next week, so hopefully that won't be an issue. Really quick to do my own sort of, quote, shout-out. On behalf of Matterall, who sometimes doesn't like to say these things, but it's important to remember that Talking in Stations is not just a show we do on Twitch, it's also ported out into a podcast. This episode might suck for people listening to that podcast, and I'm really sorry. But in order to ensure that the podcast is available and that the show is available to the most people, donations would be fantastic. Fantastic. Subscriptions are fantastic. Hosting the podcast does cost a little bit of money, so any amount you guys can give and help out is fantastic and awesome, and we thank you greatly for that. Ash, is there anything you'd like to say, final regards to people, shout-outs, etc.?
Yeah, and I'm going to try to be brief, even though I wanted this to be a bigger thing, but we're running out of time. The short of it is that I am actually building my own social media game that's kind of a micro video platform using Android devices. I am currently looking for more testers. So it is at dev.demonisoftware.com. What I will be tweeting about it more later, so if you want to know more about it, it's at Ashterothi. I've been working on it for just about a year now, and we're getting ready to go into the testing phase. So if you're willing to help me out, if you're interested, if it interests you, if you want to check out like a competitive Vine sort of game, please hit me up on Twitter and be paying attention. I'll be tweeting more about it. Thank you.
Can you drop that email in Skype and I will post it to the Twitch channel or to the chat as soon as we go off? Or can you post it, the email, without
issues?
Yeah,
hold on. Yeah. I'll just send it to you.
Okay. I have to do it
after. To answer someone's question in the stream, literally just go into iTunes podcast, type the Talking in Stations, and you'll find it. It's pretty easy to find the audio version of this podcast, which is how I listen to it.
Okay, it's linked. Okay, Engine, any shout-outs you'd like to make to people and anything?
Yeah, shout out to Even T for being cool bros.
All right, guys, that's going to be it for us. Matterall will be back next week, so this shit show will end. Sorry again, I feel so bad. So yeah, that's all. Thanks, guys. Have a great night. Bye.
Sendol Kak.